It's the final edition of the Atomic Power Racing Hour for 2015. In this episode, we are back stateside at one of the area's rising dirt tracks. For many drivers, this weekend serves as the end of the line, so some teams decided to double up before the checkered flag falls on the season. It's the last call at the port, and it's coming up next on the Atomic Power Racing Hour. Welcome to the Atomic Power Racing Hour, our final show of the 2015 season as the Go Nuclear Late Model Series visits a new facility, well, new in a lot of aspects, the Weedsport Speedway. I'm Doug Elkins, Rich Fleck, joining me here on what is a very, very cold night here in Weedsport.
It's freezing, it's fall, but you know what? They're going to go fast. Race cars like to go fast when it's cold out. We like to see fast race cars at any point in the year before Mother Nature really turns her ugly foot. And I tell you what, this new racetrack with all of these cars here in the pits, it's going to be putting all these guys on even playing field and duking it out in a very prestigious event.
It's been quite a season on the Go Nuclear Late Model Series. Lots of different winners, and the point standings are very, very close coming into this final points race of the season.
Exactly. Two drivers have really shown their stuff in terms of battling it out for the championship. The question is, who's going to pick up their second crown? That's the big answer that has to be decided over the course of this late fall weekend.
And that's going to be decided, but when we're on the points, let's go to Paul Small.
It's the final weekend of competition for the Go Nuclear Late Model Series, and the points championship has come down to a two-horse race between a couple of strong thoroughbreds, Lee Gill and Charlie Sandercock. And Lee, this is virgin territory for you in both races this weekend. You haven't seen either one of these tracks.
Yeah, it's been a few years. We were down here with a small block a couple of years ago. Didn't get qualified. It was a round of dirt week deal. Never been to Dundee, so... We're looking forward to it. Nice new facility here. They've done an awesome job with that, and have some fun.
The pressure is on. Charlie Sandercock, can you pull off another championship?
That is our goal. It's going to be extremely tough with Lee Gill ahead of us, and we're looking forward to racing with him tonight down here at this brand new facility. It should be a good show.
Only 15 points separate these two drivers coming into this final weekend.
Of course, as always, the day gets started with time trials. Those took place just a few moments ago. John Waters, fastest one in Group 1, Rich.
Oh, he's fast when he's out with the Go Nuclear Late Models. Good lap time in the first of four sessions, but the times would get even better. One of them, Brandon Moat, the Canadian competitor. First time for him to Weedsport, 16.583. He was quick despite having to work around some cars in his group time trial session.
Yeah, they always try to space them out to give the guys a little room. AJ Kingsley has a new car at this event at Weedsport, and he had it dialed in right away.
Well, if there's one race AJ wants, it might be the one. Here at Weedsport, he was the quickest of anyone in the 16.4s, as he was very fast in the 9K.
His family promoted at this track several years ago, so you know he wants this one. Alan Fink, best in group number 4. So the field is now set for the qualifying heats, and they'll be up when we come back. Welcome back to the Weedsport Speedway as the Go Nuclear Late Models battle it out on the season finale of the Atomic Power Racing Hour. As we mentioned already, this is the first trip for the series here to Weedsport, so for more on the track, let's go down to Paul Small.
Weedsport Speedway underwent an extreme makeover a couple of years ago. The track was reconfigured just a little bit, but the big thing has been the racing surface. Now, in the spring, there was a red clay on this racetrack, but it wasn't performing quite up to the promotional team standard. So what did they do? They peeled it all off, put a brand new clay surface down. It's fast, it's racy, and this track has plenty of banking, so there's a lot of room for side-by-side action.
Yeah, they really did do a lot of action with a lot of stuff with this racetrack. Let's take a look at the qualifying heat races, starting out with the very first one.
Mikey Wunderling, his first go nuclear start of the year, got off to a nice start. Remember the invert four for the heat races? Mikey used his outside front row starting position to get by Brandon Ford and then get out in front of John Waters. Two drivers with a lot of 360 late model experience, new into the crates, duking it out. And how about the rookie Chris Fleming? Got in a little bit too hot in the black 10, spun to the inside, falls all the way back to sixth, only taking five out of each of the qualifiers. So we will see him in the B main coming up a little bit later on.
Well, I bet he wishes he had that move maybe to do over again. Final lap now, and like you said, two guys who know each other well battling out front.
And again, the top two both make the redraw, so they danced around three and four a little bit considerately, and Mikey Wunderling would score the win.
We had a chance to talk to Mikey afterwards and find out how he did it.
Car was good, a little free. I mean, we won heat, stayed around the bottom, got a little work cut out for us, but make a couple adjustments and hopefully the car will be as good.
Adjusting well to his new crate-powered late model, qualifying heat race number two, Kyle Sopaz, fast timer, jumps out early.
Yeah, Kyle Sopaz able to get out in front of Laszlo Hollyfield, then Brandon Moat in the 46, new paint scheme for him, and that car was slicing through the field, goes down to the inside of Hollyfield, a driver that doesn't run a lot of races. Well, Brandon Moat, a regular on the Go Nuclear Late Model Tour, comes into the night doing pretty well in the point standings as well. So big implications for him here at the end of the year.
And actually misspoke there. Moat was the fast qualifier. Had a battle here for the fifth and final transfer spot.
Yeah, Greg Bellier in his red number 25, trying to hold off invader Wayne Mohawk, a driver from Western New York. Irving, New York is where he calls home. First time for him running with the Go Nuclear Late Models. And Mohawk was up to the challenge, battling with the driver that came into the night. Third in points is the gentle giant Greg Bellier. He would get by him for a little bit, but then Bellier got down to the bottom and put his number 25 in the fifth and final transfer position to put himself into the feature event.
And all the years, he never really ran down here at Weedsport. Last lap now, Kyle Sopaz out front and cruising. So he gets the win in the second qualifying heat. We had a chance to talk to him afterwards as well.
This track's different than anything we've ever run on before. It's a fun track. I backed into the corner a couple times, a little hot, but we managed to save it and come out with the win.
Third heat race now, and out in front early on this one. Look on the outside, easy to see that yellow and green car of Jeremy Wunderling.
Mr. Excitement, they call him. He knows how to fly around the racetrack, but so does the other three of Kevin Cook, a rookie. They have full time for the late model division. Driver out of Constantia will get into second, and some other local crop battling through the field, including a quick timer in this group, AJ Kingsley in the 9K. Remember, the top two make the redraw. Kingsley would push up while running in fourth. Dustin Waters would close in on that battle, but then Waters had a deal with another rookie, 33 of Jason Occhino out of Fulton.
Yeah, Occhino, unlike a lot of the guys, actually came up from the sportsman ranks here. Billy Isley's the guy right there in the 18 that's trying to work on them. And again, two guys who really don't know this track at all.
No, and everybody kind of falls into that suit. Kevin Cook, Brian Knowles, they would battle it out for the second and final redraw position. And it would be Cook holding off that spot. But as you can see, pulling away from the rest of the field, Mr. Excitement, Jeremy Wunderling, down on the bottom. Like his brother Mikey, had no problem picking up a heat race win.
Always liked the short tracks, and he was good in this one. He told us how he did it.
It's only the second time I've ever been here, and it's a lot different facility than it was when I was here last time. That was 8-10 years ago. It's a nice place. Racetrack's nice. Started outside pole, that was help, and car worked really good. The only thing that I had to complain at all was a little bit of hole getting into one and two, but you can drive around it, so it shouldn't really be an issue. Should be some good racing.
Bob McCready used to say years ago, just because the hole's there doesn't mean you have to drive through it. Here we're looking at Charlie Sandercock as he starts third in the final heat.
This is a loaded heat race for sure. You got the top two in points, including Lee Gill jumping out in front. He's the points leader with the chance to get his second championship. Well, Sandercock had a battle with Alan Fink, and then right in front of him, Alan Chapman, the local driver from Baldwinsville, who was doing a great job holding on to second for a little while, but then Fink and Sandercock were up to the task. They moved to the inside of the 64 on the second lap.
Yeah, and Chapman didn't race a lot this year where the guys that are around him. They've been racing all year, but one thing I think is real interesting here, final points race at a track that not many people race at, really throw everything out from the season, just see what happens tonight, as Sandercock made a move here to the bottom to get the third spot.
Get to third, and remember, top two make the redraw. That was what was really important. Also, Sean Beardsley in the 18S getting up to fifth. But as Sandercock went after Alan Fink, They would get mired in a pretty good battle, and Sandercock just couldn't get the bite. A driver in that number 57 with 18 wins in 34 starts this year. That's over a 500% or 50% winning percentage.
And Alan Fink, of course, ran this track a lot in the Sportsman, but it was reconfigured at the start of this year. So, yeah, the experience helps, but you have to wonder how much. Here's the battle for second late in the race.
Yeah, late in the race, Sean Beardsley would make it a three-car battle. Here on the final lap, they would all hold their spot in line, and Lee Gill was checking out from the pack. Doug, this is our sixth Go Nuclear Late Model Series race of the year that we're showing here on the Atomic Power Racing Hour. I think it's Lee Gill's third or fourth heat win.
He has been fast all year. He'll tell us how he was fast in qualifying heat number four.
Tonight we had a good time trial. Got started on, just happened to fall in that front row there, and not sure how we're stacking up overall, but car seems to be pretty good. Should be a good night for us.
As we mentioned, the top two finishers from each heat got to redraw for their A-main starting spot, and it was Canadian Kyle Sopaz drawing the pole position. Paul Small has caught up with the man that will lead the field to the green in tonight's 40-lap feature event.
Something tells me Kyle Sopaz should be playing the lottery, because this is the second race in a row where you've drawn the pole.
Yeah, it is. Charlie Sandercock said, grab the first ball that your finger touches, and it happened to be the one this time. Last race we drew for the Go Nuclear was the crate race, and it was the same thing. I just went with my gut, scooped an apple, and it was one again. We finished third there, behind two really stout competitors, so we're hoping we can pull off another good run here tonight.
Tonight he wants to be the jackrabbit instead of one of the hounds.
So we know who will start on the pole, but the entire field is not yet set. Some top names like Chris Fleming still need to qualify through the B main, which is coming up next on the Atomic Power Racing Hour. Don't go anywhere.
Electricity. You flip a switch, the lights go on. But will we have safe supplies of electricity to meet our fast-growing needs? Today, nuclear energy provides 1/5 of America's electricity. Tomorrow, it could supply even more. And nuclear power plants don't emit greenhouse gases, so they preserve our environment. We need to reduce our dependence on foreign energy. And we also need clean air. With nuclear energy, we can do both. Nuclear. Putting clean air energy to work.
The Go Nuclear Late Model Challenge Series is presented by XL Tower Service, Atomic Chassis, Humber Nurseries, Deerhaven Victory, Grills and Ovens, Ensinger Performance, Gillies Napa, Dibbitt's Excavating, BA Custom Headers, SUNY Canton, C. Smith Automotive Machine Shop, McDonald Homes, Trick Race Parts, HBH Super Suckers, and Tenace Music Systems.
We're back here at the Weedsport Speedway, where the B-Main is on track for the Go Nuclear Late Models. A strong field tonight naturally means a loaded last chance race, with names like Chris Fleming having one last chance to qualify. It's been a great rookie season for this driver on tour, and earlier he spoke with our Paul Small.
He's been one of the hot rookies this season on the Go Nuclear Late Model Series. Chris Fleming, tell us about this maiden voyage for you on this tour.
Oh, it's been a lot of fun, a lot of new tracks, a lot of new competition, a lot of good competition. When you're racing against Charlie Sandercock and Lee Gill, you definitely learn a lot. But just having a lot of fun, and we're starting to get some experience on these new tracks and know what to expect, and I think that's paying off.
He also won a track championship against a lot of established guys at the Fulton Speedway. Well, he's in a good position here. He's got the pole position for this B main.
Right, but you never want to be in the B main. For Fleming, he could finish as high as fourth in the standings this weekend when it's all said and done. A lot of rookies in this field. Also, Adam Turner, who won one of the races we didn't see on the Atomic Power Racing Hour, but he did win up at Mohawk with the Go Nuclear Late Models, his first tour win in 4 years of competition.
Tony Finch the second. A little surprised to see him out here as well. This is fun seeing some different guys on this race here in Weedsport as we get the green. 10 laps the distance here for the B main.
And again, the top four to qualify. That's the important thing right now. Adam Turner and Jason Aquino hold on to those spots with Brian Down running in spot number five. Billy Isley trying to make his way up through the pack in the black number 18. Had a runner-up finish with us at the Utica Rome Speedway back in July, and he gets around the number 98 of Kevin Hill.
Yeah, you can see Hill's car got wide on him or just got a little bit loose. This is a D-shaped track, so the backstretch does go out a little bit. The front stretch is straight, so if you do go into three too hard, the back end will come around as we watch Jason Aquino trying to run down Adam Turner.
Adam Turner, as we said, had a win at Mohawk, but a lot of his tour races this year has been mired to the B main. Has had trouble in his qualifying heats and time trials. Right now runs back in third. Chris Fleming checking out. We saw his mistake in the heat race. No mistakes so far. Three laps home.
And he did run an IMCA modified race here earlier this year. So unlike some of the other guys, he does have an idea of what to expect as we watch this battle for third still going on. And actually trying to make it a four-car race for that spot.
Yeah, as Billy Isley has quickly closed in. Remember the 33, the final car that would transfer in right now. Aquino, driver regular at Fulton, had a very nice season there. Two wins, fourth in points, and they run there every Saturday night with these late models.
And he's going to see a car that was inside here very, very soon. He's probably thinking he just has a one car to deal with at this point, but all it takes is one little slip, and Isley can find his way to the inside, which is exactly what he's trying to do.
And still, Adam Turner might be the slowest of the three.
Yes, I think so.
At 17 with a 92 up on top in memory of Craig Revell. He drives down to the inside. Now up to the top goes Isley, side by side for fourth.
Yeah, he was trying the bottom and realized it wasn't going to work because that's where Jason Aquino's going to go. Oh, contact, and Aquino goes around.
Oh, man. Tough break for Jason Aquino. The 33, former sportsman competitor, and into the late models here full-time in 2015, was holding on to the fourth and final transfer spot. A little bit of contact. And
yeah,
we'll
let's take a look here. Of course, Aquino, like I said, new into this division, but, man, it just, I don't know, it didn't look like that hard of contact, and around it went.
We'll see it again here. Maybe just washed up a little bit. Look at the left front to see if that locked up on the brakes.
No,
it doesn't
it
appear that it did. So he'll have to go to the back and have to get up to that fourth spot that he was in. Looked like the car just washed up. And that wasn't at the spot that we normally see here at Weedsport where things tighten up off of turn four. That was still entering turn four.
Just a bad break for him right there. And here's our first look at the Delaware restart, which is pretty much a late model thing all across the country. The leader does have the front row to themselves. Second place has choice inside or outside. And right now, Chris Fleming looking very, very strong. Alan Chapman on the inside of row number two. The green is out, as you can see from his vantage point coming out of turn four with Alan Chapman trying to get up through the field.
And Wayne Mohawk goes to the inside, gets around the eight of Brian Down. And look at Billy Isley now having to fight once again to get into that transfer spot. Down to the inside he goes. He gets by the Trenton, Ontario driver and back into the fourth and final transfer position.
All right, so now he's up to fourth.
And
he goes around.
Wow.
You could almost see that getting ready to happen, couldn't you?
Oh, tough break for Billy Isley. A good guy in racing, no question about that. Resident up near the Can-Am Motorsports Park where he had a tour win two or three years ago. And Brian Down, really no lift in that eight.
Yeah, reminded me of a little incident at NASCAR earlier this year with a couple of yellow cars. But, yeah, that's about as blatant as it can get right there. He didn't like the pass, and there we go. Brian Down was sent to the tail for that, and really the penalty could have been even more severe on that.
Yeah, the penalty's really on Billy Isley, though. There's three laps to go, and he's at the back. I'll tell you, a guy moving up through is Jason Aquino as he's closing back in on a top four transfer spot.
Yeah, a couple of more spots, and he will be into that position. You just caught a glimpse of him on the bottom side of the racetrack. Here's second, third, fourth, and fifth. You see Aquino there on the inside in the 33 trying to work the number 19 of Aaron Backus.
Aaron Backus really has run just Fulton this year, so has not ventured away from that track too often. Be nice for him to get into the show in that number 19. But here comes Aquino down to the inside. A couple guys that duke it out on Saturday nights, typically here in their late season event. trying to sort it out for fourth, and Backus a little bit out of sorts going into turn number three.
And you could see Aquino was being cautious that time, lifted early to make sure that he didn't have contact, but he can't lift anymore. It's a last lap now.
Up the speedway goes the number 19. Jason Aquino down to the inside, takes the final transfer spot away.
So he is in fourth position. Who's out front? Chris Fleming. Comfortable win for him in the B main.
And also making it into the show, Adam Turner, Wayne Mohawk, and Jason Aquino. Well, the rest will be headed home unless they have a provisional to fall back on.
Wow. What good racing here in the heats. Let's check in with our Paul Small. Learn more about these late models in our Tech Minute.
So far this year on the Atomic Power Racing Hour, we've talked about the engines and the tires and the suspension on a Go Nuclear late model, but we haven't talked about the transmissions and the drivetrain that actually put the power to the ground. These transmissions are pretty unique. Let's take a look at this one that's on the underside of Lee Gill's race car. This is it. It's a small transmission because it only has two forward gears and one reverse gear. You basically put it in low, and then as you let the clutch out, not press the clutch in, you bang it into the main drive gear, and it's a one-to-one ratio or direct drive that transfers from the transmission down this drive shaft into a quick change rear end assembly. It's called a quick change because you could pull the back of the rear end off and change the gears. You only have a choice of two gear ratios to run, a 411 or a 486. Most drivers actually prefer the 411 because it has a taller drive gear. You can make that lighter. Lighter rotating weight, more speed.
Well, the feature field is now set, and all that there is to do is run the race. There is pole sitter Kyle Sopas, and he knows he better fill up. It's a 40-lap event, and it's coming up on the other side of this break. Don't go away.
Sick of staticky headphones you bought at the dollar store? Come to your senses and enjoy music once again. At Sense, we recognize that not one size fits all. It's your music. Sense believes it should be your choice in how to listen to it. Enjoy crystal clear audio with comfortable and fresh styles that suit you. Don't conform to the norm. Get what you want and listen with your senses.
Planning a trip to Victory Lane? Let Atomic Chassis get you there. Atomic Chassis are built with a high attention to detail using superior parts from trusted manufacturers such as BPM, Winners, Bernheisel, Bilstein, All-Star Performance, Vulcan, and many more. With superior craftsmanship and materials, you know Atomic will last. And since each customer becomes a part of our family, you aren't treated like just another number. So visit AtomicChassis.com today to plan your next trip to Victory Lane. It's four wide time here at Weedsport Speedway for the inaugural race of the Go Nuclear late models at this historic track that has had an enormous facelift to shine as it does tonight. This is one of the strongest fields we have seen all season, and a new track could make for a surprising winner, especially when you consider that cold conditions have made things interesting with the racing surface. Our Paul Small made this report just a moment ago.
Well, this feature event is certainly going to be interesting, and that's because a 125-lap modified race was contested before this Go Nuclear late model feature rolls out onto the racetrack. And as a result, you've got some sections of the track that are starting to break up here in turn number three. This is probably about a 2 or 3 inch difference between the bottom level of the racetrack and up here. Now, above it, smooth. Below it, smooth and bite. Problem is, you don't want to hit this stuff in the middle, man. It's going to hurt.
That's right. They did run a 358 series race here earlier tonight, so this is a lot different racetrack than the guys saw a couple of hours ago.
Absolutely, and it's even colder than it was before.
jetting up those carburetors, running a little bit more fuel mixture in there. We are ready to go. 40 laps, Lee Gill and Kyle Sopaz on the front row.
With John Waters and Kevin Cook, row number two. You got Alan Fink, Jeremy Wonderling, row number three. No shortage of heavy hitters throughout this field.
And a lot of new drivers, which is a lot of fun to see as well. Brian Knowles, Charlie Sandercock, a couple of longtime veterans right there in row number six.
And A.J. Kingsley, Sean Beardsley, drivers that will have to work from further back, like Greg Bellier, third in points. He's going to have some work to do. We've documented Chris Fleming and Adam Turner, two guys that have done very well on tour this season, starting back in row number 11, all the way back to Billy Eisley in 26th. And keep an eye on a guy like Dale Caswell, starting in 9th. We haven't talked about him yet. Driving Greg Bellier's backup car tonight, the 25C, after his car was unable to start in hot laps.
And, of course, he has experience here for a lot of IMCA modified races. But, again, this is a different track. It's a whole new ballgame, same location, but it is a different speedway as we get the green on lap number one.
And John Waters already going to try to slot into second. Couldn't get by Lee Gill. And right after him comes Kevin Cook for the number three spot.
Cook down on the bottom. You see Fink and Wonderling right there. They're battling for position number five. Wonderling trying the inside. Contact there off turn four. Yeah. Little accordion effect happened there.
Cook and Fink came together. And now here comes Mikey Wonderling into the back of Fink. Fink goes around. And Wonderling blocks the track. Yellow flies with a lap home. And it looks like Adam Turner going to have some damage as well. And I think Aaron Jacobs
Yep. Won the race earlier this year at Utica Rome. But Alan Fink brings out the yellow along with Mikey Wonderling. Early problems here for Adam Turner. That is pretty. So of course, the tire's locked up. It's riding on some sheet metal there, so it might be okay. Let's take a look here.
Yeah, everything had kind of jingled up off of turn number four, and I think Mikey came in at a too low of an angle in the 74 and too hot and really nowhere to go. Got into the side of Alan Fink. Tough break for Fink.
Yes. Because he was just riding around, and you could see Wonderling. Wow. Yeah, see, it's still on some sheet metal there, so I don't know if that's actually locked up or just not making contact with the racetrack. We're going to find out now. Wow. There we go.
There it is.
So he might be okay, but probably a good idea to head to the pits and just to make sure.
Yep, going to take a pit side.
That's one of the things they did here, too. They changed the whole pit location.
Yes.
Used to be a hard right-hander off of turn one. Now it's just an easy right-hander right there in the middle of three and four. Here's Kyle Sopaz, and he's seeing exactly what he wants to see right now, a clean racetrack.
Absolutely. Going after his first career Go Nuclear Late Model Tour win. Has had some good runs this year.
Yes.
Broke through at his hometown track, Brighton Speedway, with two wins this year. But a Go Nuclear win would mean a heck of a lot more.
There he goes. He wants it, but he is not going to have an easy time of it here as he's got some hungry drivers right behind him as they work through turns one and two. Boy, that Wonderling car is so easy to spot, isn't it?
Absolutely. John Waters, though, up into spot number two. And now going after Sopaz for the race lead. Puts the 11 down to the inside. Waters, who has won a number of races this year, just none on the Go Nuclear Late Model Tour.
That's true. He has been very strong. You just haven't seen it on TV. Here goes Wonderling to the inside of Gill as they battle for third, and there's a battle now for the lead.
Boy, Waters has got his car flowing right now as the 11 puts it to the outside and gets around Kyle Sopaz to take the lead with four home.
You had to do it, didn't you? New leader here on lap number four as we see what Kyle Sopaz sees. And you can see he's trying to get to the bottom, but he is really working that wheel.
And Doug, you have heard it from drivers plenty of times before. If you're committed to a lane and you're not able to transfer from one group to the other, you've just got to play the cards you've been dealt.
There you go. Dale Caswell, that's going to take a little bit of getting used to
seeing
him in that car right there as the field goes by. We got a slow car up on the high side of the racetrack. That is the 64 of Alan Chapman. And now it looks like he's picking up the pace again, so we're going to stay green.
Yeah, good news for that. And Kevin Cook trying to go back after Lee Gill as they duke it out now for fourth and fifth, sliding a few spots back. Still a couple of champions, the last three champions, actually, in one-time champion Sandercock and two-time champion Caswell. They're back in seventh place as the first ever champion and current points leader Lee Gill in fourth and going after Wonderling for third.
Hasn't really been able to do much with him here this past few laps. You can see he's looking around to try to find a fast groove on the racetrack. And I noticed, like Paul said, with the little bit of bumps on the inside, most of the guys are choosing the outside part of the racetrack right now. And as we say that, Gill goes down to the bottom.
And you said earlier, you don't have to go through the stuff that might be a little bit ruffled. but sometimes it can be the fast place to get the car to shut down, get bite, and go. And that's what Lee Gill just did. Drives it off that inside of turn number two that we've seen so many drivers do here at Weedsport, no matter the configuration. Slides it down to the inside and has third taken away with a nice slide job around Jeremy Wunderling. Wunderling smells the back end as he goes into turn number one.
And I think Kevin Cook saw that move, and he's going to try to do the very same thing. And one lap later, just like that, Wunderling loses two spots.
Yeah, those cars are pretty good, though, Gill and Cook. Meanwhile, the leader is into lap traffic and already lapping Adam Turner. John Waters now goes to the inside of Wayne Mohawk, puts the 64M lap down, and goes after a fellow Southern Tier driver, Mikey Wunderling, to put the 74 a lap behind the rest of the field.
Yeah, Wunderling, if you remember, was involved in that spin earlier. That's how he ended up going to the back of the pack as we watch 2, 3, 4, and 5 come down the front stretch.
Yeah, another driver up to life. No surprise. Defending champion Charlie Sandercock in the 57 sliding through the middle. Look at this with lap cars. The 17's a lap car. Everybody else right now is not. And 2, 3, 4, and 5 are stacked up on the bottom.
I think Charlie Sandercock made the wise decision there not to shove his nose in there. But hey,
wow,
I tell you, he's faster
fast
than Cook. He's going, he's going to crisscross and try to go to the bottom.
As we mentioned earlier, he's won more than half of the late model races he's competed in this year. Also won a 360 sprint car race at Brighton Speedway back on Labor Day weekend. So a versatile driver that knows how to get it done.
Well, Waters is missing all this good stuff back here in positions 2, 3, 4. And you wonder why these guys spend all this time and do all this work working on these cars. It's for moments like these guys are having right now, because even though they might not like where they are, they're having a ball. And
Look
at Sandercock on the outside up to second place.
We saw him do that at a Schweiken back in June on the outside, down to the bottom, through the middle, and up into position
number three. Actually, yes. So somebody lost a roof support there. I saw it bouncing around on the top side of the racetrack. So now this is positions 4 and 5 right here. Sopaz in the 12. And I wonder if Sandercock is going to be running down second place Lee Gill.
Yeah, three stout drivers in front of the field right now. John Waters, obviously, always up near the front of the pack. And then the top two in points, second and third, respectively. And it looks like Gill and Sandercock are reeling in the leader.
Yeah, if he had a rear-view mirror in the car right now, he'd be noticing that. But, of course, there are no rear-view mirrors, but we have now a three-car battle at the front with lots of lap traffic right in front of them.
There are no rear-view mirrors, but there's a big screen off in turn number three.
That might help them.
I doubt it, but it might. Anyways, battle for second. Sandercock, remember, we talked in the open. He's got to not just beat Lee Gill. He's got to get as many points as possible to win. Pick set up by the lap car, and here goes Gill to the outside, the veteran.
Well, that's a pure veteran move right there. He saw the slower car in the bottom, beat Waters to the outside lane. He's got the lead. Waters now will go up to the top side. Sandercock's still thinking about the bottom, but I think eventually, he gave him a little tap there, get him loose, and I think I probably would have done the same thing.
Now Chapman went, moved over, and now Kevin Cook is right there in the 3X. So four cars really in the mix. We're not even halfway yet.
This is good stuff here.
I
wondered how this race was going to be at Weedsport. New track. The cars hadn't been on it. They are putting on quite a show here. There's Gill. You just caught a look at him as he's trying to go through the middle. Actually, I think that's going to work, but look at everybody behind him. This is crazy.
Well, again, the 125, the 57, the 3X, and the 11 are on the lead lap. Everybody else is getting the lap. Andy Mayhew, Sean Beardsley, and look at Sandercock.
Oh.
The meat and the sandwich. They get together. And across goes Sandercock. Oh, flips it over.
Boy, you just had a feeling that was way too tight, that something was going to happen, and it sure did. Red flag out. The cars will stop for Wayne Mohawk, who is on his roof. The worst position any driver wants to be in. Sean Beardsley, the other car involved with him there.
Sean Beardsley, heavy contact for some of the lap cars. Looks like a flat right front tire for John Waters as well in the 11.
It might be, yeah.
Oh, man, but hopefully everything okay with Mohawk. The first time for him racing with the Go Nuclear late models, and we'll take a look and see what happened, Doug.
Now watch him here off of turn number 4.
I think it starts
going through the middle, Sandercock in the white car.
And he's just trying to push through the lap cars and didn't push through equally, and boy, nowhere for Mohawk to go, and you see the rear axle come flying out of the car. Wow.
And that was a pretty heavy hit on Sean Beardsley's left rear as well, so I would imagine. Watch it right there. Oh, that's a hard hit. I would be surprised if Beardsley's going to be able to continue here.
I agree. We didn't get a good shot of it, but
watch it here, though.
And Sandercock, we'll see how much damage he has as we watch the rest of the issues, but it looks like he was able to drive away.
and actually left front damage on Beardsley's car, too. He got hit twice there. Now, most tracks, they won't roll him over because they're afraid about the check ball and the fuel cell and maybe a fire issue, so they're going to try to get him out this way. While they do that, we'll take a break. What a race it is here in Weedsport. Don't go anywhere. We've still got a lot of laps to go here on the Atomic Power Racing Hour. Planning a trip to Victory Lane? Let Atomic Chassis get you there. Atomic Chassis are built with a high attention to detail using superior parts from trusted manufacturers such as BPM, Winners, Bernheisel, Bilstein, All-Star Performance, Vulcan, and many more. With superior craftsmanship and materials, you know Atomic will last. And since each customer becomes a part of our family, you aren't treated like just another number. So visit AtomicChassis.com today to plan your next trip to Victory Lane.
Electricity. You flip a switch, the lights go on. But will we have safe supplies of electricity to meet our fast-growing needs? Today, nuclear energy provides one-fifth of America's electricity. Tomorrow, it could supply even more. And nuclear power plants don't emit greenhouse gases, so they preserve our environment. We need to reduce our dependence on foreign energy. And we also need clean air. With nuclear energy, we can do both. Nuclear. Putting clean air energy to work.
Sick of staticky headphones you bought at the dollar store? Come to your senses and enjoy music once again. At Sense, we recognize that not one size fits all. It's your music. Sense believes it should be your choice in how to listen to it. Enjoy crystal clear audio with comfortable and fresh styles that suit you. Don't conform to the norm. Get what you want and listen with your senses.
Welcome back to the Atomic Power Racing Hour. First ever show here at the Weedsport Speedway in Weedsport, New York. Also the season finale for the Go Nuclear Late Model Series. A lot of damage to a lot of cars on this last caution. Doug Elkins with Rich Vleck. Oh, the Waters car. I didn't see he sustained that much damage either.
Yeah, so three guys really got knocked out of that. Also Chris Fleming involved and a few others that got knocked out just because of the accordion effect. Glad to hear Wayne Mohawk okay, though. And a tough break for Sean Beardsley in the 18. You know, came into the weekend fourth in points and had two guys nipping at his heels. He might fall a little bit in the standings. But the top two in points are now the top two in the race. Lee Gill ahead of Charlie Sandercock and Kevin Cook with Kyle Sopaz back and forth. Our pole sitter still getting a good look at the front of the field.
So Lee Gill just took the lead right before we went to break. We had some wild action. If you missed it, it was really something. You see Sandercock on the bottom, Kevin Cook on the outside of row number two. Green flag is back out.
And they rock it into turn number one. Down on the inside, Charlie Sandercock got involved with the lap cars but appeared to have the quickest. Falls behind Cook, though. Kevin Cook able to come to life into turn number three and go after Lee Gill.
And Cook again for a rookie. Look at this. He's going to the inside. We've got a new leader down in turn number one, and it's rookie Kevin Cook.
Boy, and he's just muscling that through turn number one and two. And you wonder what he did. Doug, that was about a 20-minute red flag. It's, what, 32 degrees out right now. Could the car have gone through a heat cycle with the tires? Did he get them heated up a little bit better than somebody else? Or somebody else's tires sealed over? Whatever the case is, Cook's long gone, and here goes Sandercock around Lee Gill for second.
Yeah, because you saw Lee Gill trying to get his tires warm before that restart, and now he's, if he doesn't watch it here, he's going to be back in third, and Sandercock has got the spot,
contact.
Little contact, and still contact down to front stretch.
Well, they're somewhat friends, but this weekend they're frenemies going for the championship, and that's a big move for Sandercock, who came into the night 15 points behind Lee Gill. That's about 6 to 7 positions that he has to gain this weekend.
And of course, you saw that contact on the right rear quarter panel. Those supports there are meant to bend. So unlike a stock car,
yes,
where that would send him around,
right,
he might not have even known that that contact was there.
Very, very correct. Now, look at this damage on Brian Knowles,
number seven.
He's got seventh taken away from Dale Caswell. Yes, that's Dale Caswell, the 25C, driving Greg Bellier's backup car. Pork chop, Brian Knowles, with a nice little move on the inside, despite having no left side sheet metal.
Well, about the we got a yellow here. I was going to say the only thing that'll hurt him on is possibly the scales around Alan Chapman, the driver from Baldwinsville, and he will bring out our yellow. Earlier we asked Kyle and the others what they plan to do in the offseason. It's this week's question of the hour.
Rebuild, rebuild, rebuild. Take this thing right down to bare chassis.
We stay in the shop pretty much year round, so get ready for next year, and hopefully I can do a couple races over the winter someplace down south, get away from the snow a little bit.
I plan on getting this car ready for next year, and then hopefully just have a good time with the family and not stress about too much about the race car.
Preparing for a wedding, and I got a little one on the way, so probably preparing for her to show up and enjoying that, I guess.
Spending as much time with my son as I can. Watching that little guy grow up is pretty cool. Just seeing all the things that he does new, it just makes everything so much better.
It's amazing how, in order to do this, it does sacrifice some family time. So that usually is every racer's number one goal in the offseason. Get to know the family again as we've got 16 laps to go here in Weedsport.
Make up time, yes, absolutely. You got to do it. Right now, you got Lee Gill up on the top lane, Charlie Sandercock on the bottom. We saw some contact earlier. Will it happen once again? Sandercock slides up, holds the brake, holds the bottom line, allows Lee Gill to get his momentum in the 125.
Lee Gill trying the outside, to get back up to second spot. You can see Sandercock's car is a little bit loose there. Made it work, though, kept the spot as they go down the front stretch and into turn number one.
Yeah, so Sandercock's got second. Can he go get Kevin Cook for the lead? Again, in order to score the championship, either something needs to happen to Gill or Sandercock needs to win tonight to keep his hopes alive.
And the car without the number on the side, without the sheet metal, that's Brian Knowles. And despite the damage, that car's still running pretty well out there.
Absolutely, doing a good job with Caswell and Kingsley behind him. And the battle's shaping up for the race lead, Doug.
Kevin Cook leads. Charlie Sandercock has run him down. He was in third place just a couple of laps ago. So this tells you that he is a little bit faster, but Cook has been very, very tough this year, part of a rookie crop that included Chris Fleming. But this will be interesting to see how this works with 12 laps to go.
Kevin Cook with three wins at Fulton, one at Brewerton this year in his late model, but very few starts on the Go Nuclear late model tour. This one's looking good, but still a dozen laps left to go.
And this track is somewhat similar to Brewerton. So for a guy like Kevin Cook, I'm sure he put the Brewerton setup in and kind of went from there, but it looks like Sandercock is running him down.
That's what a lot of the drivers told me before we got going today, was we're going to stay close to Brewerton, Fulton stuff. But right now, Cook pushes into turn number one, and Sandercock's your new leader.
I wonder if he hit a little inconsistency in the track surface there. That thing just shot up, but he's going to go right back forward here. So Sandercock, and he's going to go around.
Kevin Cook, that's the second time we've seen that today, where a driver tried to get a spot back going into turn number three. And Doug, we can't illustrate enough the D-shaped effect of that back straightaway. Things narrow up real quick going into turn three and four.
Yeah, because it's so gradual when you go into turn three, and then right about there in the middle is where it tightens up, and that's when things, you start leaning over the right side of the car more. But that was almost exactly like what we saw Jason Aquino do earlier. Pretty much same spot, same reaction.
Nope.
Has he got a problem?
Well, I don't know if he's got a problem with the 57. I thought that was more of his own doing, but he's going to show some displeasure. We'll see if there's a little bit more from that. Okay, I'll move on.
Well, sometimes that's the best way to do it. Pull up next to him, let him know, make a hand gesture or two, and then go back to the rear of the field. Let's take a look at what happened. This is the battle for the lead.
Yeah, Sandercock does come down there. Boy, that's a tough one to tell because Cook
had
a run that I'm sure he would have washed up the track. That's a racing deal for sure, Doug.
Yeah, and if this was for eighth place, it'd be different, but it's for the lead.
Yes.
It's late in the race.
It's past midnight.
Yeah, it's tough to know. And, well, here's Kyle Sopas. He's been kind of quietly hanging back here, third, fourth, fifth. You got to wonder if he has something for the leaders. And Brandon Moat, too, in the 46.
Spot on. Brandon Moat, a guy that has never finished in the top three in a Go Nuclear race. This would be a big deal for him. Slips up a little bit, and Brett Belden, first time we've called the number 81 here tonight, as he's up to fourth, A.J. Kingsley up to sixth, so some drivers moving up the pecking order with 10 to go.
And Belden does not know this track at all. He spent his time on the Outlaw Circuit. Weedsport ran Sundays, Utica Rome ran Sundays, so he was never here in Weedsport, as we could see this action on the bottom with Sopas, who lost a few spots on that restart.
Yeah, A.J. Kingsley's car coming to life, the 9K, his shop just a few miles down the road, literally from right here at the Weedsport Speedway. Looks like Belden pushes up a little bit. Kingsley might have position number four.
And Kingsley, if you remember the last race that we had on TV, was up in Canada by himself, and it seemed every caution there was, he was in it, so he wants to have a good showing today.
And yet he still finished in the top 10 that night. But like you said, he was all by himself, no crew. Tonight, he's got a ton of people watching him.
And Brett Belden, he does pit next to Kingsley. So these two guys, they know each other very well. Belden ran on the series that Kingsley's father promoted for many years. So these guys, Kingsley actually grew up watching Belden race. So you know these guys are going to run each other cleanly.
Yep, and they ran Fulton together all season long. Belden around the outside, still holding a lot of momentum in that number 81. And still has position number four, but Kingsley might have him here. Got a good entrance into turn number one and two. They got that. Oh, problem with the leader.
Sandercock slows on the backstretch. You have to wonder if it was from that contact earlier. It looks like a suspension issue, and there goes the right rear tire, axle, and everything.
Oh, that's going to end the night, Doug.
That is going to be
that's
a night
end the
ender.
Championship.
And hopefully that tire won't get in somebody else's way. I'm surprised it's still on the car. I've never seen one out that far with the axle in it staying on the car.
I'm not sure if he knows exactly what it looks like right now. The yellow flag is out. And as we said, Sandercock going for the championship, leading the race. It looks like it's all gone away.
Just like that. Things can happen quickly here on the Go Nuclear Late Model Series. Sandercock, your race leader. Well, this is going to be a tough one for him here at Weedsport. We'll get back to racing when we come back. Only a few laps left. Charlie Sandercock to the pits, but we've got more racing to go here on the Atomic Power Racing Hour. Welcome back to the Atomic Power Racing Hour here in Weedsport, New York. It's the season finale for the Go Nuclear Late Models. New race leader, Lee Gill out front after Charlie Sandercock broke while leading. And we've got just five laps to go, Rich.
That means the championship pretty much settled as long as Lee Gill can finish this race. But can he get his second tour win of the year? We're about to find out. He gets the green flag. And how about A.J. Kingsley going for second?
He has just worked his way through the field methodically. And like you said, Brandon Moat, he's still looking for his first top three. But Kingsley, you know he wants this one at a track. His family knows well. Brett Belden back and forth, three wide for a moment for fifth.
Alan Fink, after spinning out on lap number two, has moved his way through the pack, going for fifth right now with Kyle Sopas. Nice run up through the field for Fink.
And remember, Kevin Cook went to the back there just a few laps ago.
Yeah.
And now he is in position number six, so he'd love to salvage the night with a nice top five here.
Yeah, that's a terrific battle for
really
both
is.
Of those drivers that have rebounded nicely here at the Weedsport Speedway, but just three more laps left to get it done. Brett Belden doing anything he can to hold off Fink for position number four.
Another two guys here. Actually, these three guys, they run together at Fulton Speedway on Saturday night, so they know each other well. There'll be two to go when we come around this time.
Yeah, Lee Gill checked out from the field, looking to put the exclamation point and the cherry on top of what will be his second championship. His first was in the series' inaugural season back 2011.
And there you can see Brandon Moat. This will be his best Go Nuclear late model finish. If he can hold on to second place, he only has one more lap to do it.
And it doesn't look like without the aid of a caution, he's going to be able to catch the leader. Lee Gill said he had been here one other time a ton of years ago, never in a late model. He made it look pretty easy tonight. Got a little help, but he's going to score the 40-lap feature event.
And the championship as well. Moat, just held off A.J. Kingsley for second place there. Brett Belden in position four. Alan Fink rounds out the top five. And still a good run for Kevin Cook coming from the back late after that spin to get his sixth place.
Yeah, a bunch of good stories in the top ten. We'll chronicle it as the fireworks go off. The only thing that'll heat up tonight, as it has been a very cold night of temperatures and a hot night on the racetrack. Lee Gill scores his second win of the year, his fifth career tour win. We talked about the top five and Kevin Cook in sixth. Pole sitter Kyle Sopas, decent run in seventh. Dale Caswell in a backup ride, never had been in the car before. Eighth, Brian Knowles, no left side
nothing.
panels, finishes in ninth, and good run for Brandon Ford in tenth.
There you see Charlie Sandercock back there in 15th. That's what happened to him after problems with the right rear. Laszlo Holyfield was strong early. He ended up in 17th. And Chris Fleming, he's got to really be feeling it after this one. 18th place, he was a lot better car than that.
Yep, for the local driver that really wanted to put on a good show. All these drivers falling out, many of them in the lap 20 incident. John Waters, Sean Beardsley, and Wayne Mohawk in that big crash on the front straightaway.
We're going to catch up with our leader. Our Paul Small is down in victory lane.
Lee Gill makes it to victory lane in tonight's Go Nuclear Late Model Series race at Weedsport. For a while, Lee, it looked like nobody wanted to win this race because whoever was up front was having some kind of catastrophe.
Track was pretty rough tonight. It was a make your stuff last type of night. Had a couple of different tire compounds we could choose tonight too, and with the cautions, it's moved guys around a lot. The soft tires would come in short term, and then hard tires, you know, after we get a little bit of a run. But all in all, just trying to keep the wheels on her for 40 laps.
And in the big picture, you win the race. Charlie Sandercock has problems, falls out of the race. That puts you in the catbird seat for a championship.
Yeah, it's I'd rather race him. We've had a lot of fun this summer. Hate to see him get broke up because of, you know, rough racetrack. Tears the race car up. I would have rather raced him to the end.
Lee Gill winds up victorious here tonight at Weedsport.
I don't know how he can stay so calm like that after everything that just happened. So here are the point standings.
And again, the difference now, so much, 57 points. It does not look like Charlie Sandercock will be able to reel in Lee Gill as they go to Black Rock tomorrow. So we can pretty much award Lee Gill the championship, but still some point battles to be discussed as you see drivers like Kyle Sopaz and Brandon Moat in fifth. Moat was second in the race. He's down with Paul.
Brandon Moat finishes in the second spot tonight at Weedsport. It's a pretty wild night, wasn't it?
Yeah, very wild. The track was actually really rougher than I thought it would be, and I've never been here, so this is the first time.
And you guys had to battle your way through traffic, and then you had some stop and go there towards the end, too.
Yeah, there's a lot of traffic and just dodging the ruts, and it was, yeah, rough.
But all in all, you got to be happy with the second place. The car's a one piece, and you almost won this thing.
Yeah, I'll take that. It's the best run I've had in the Go Nuclear sides so far, so yeah, it's good.
That's Brandon Moat, your runner-up finisher here at Weedsport.
Great run for him. Let's take a look at how this all shook out. It was a wild one here tonight in Weedsport.
Well, we had a lot of passes for the lead on the racetrack. It started with John Waters getting around Kyle Sopaz by using the top of the speedway. He got around him, checked out for a while, but then some other drivers started to move up. Lee Gill able to get by Sopaz as well on lap number 12. Well, they started to dice it into the lap traffic. And then Gill, along with Charlie Sandercock, able to reel in John Waters. It looked like Sandercock was going to take the lead, but the pick was set properly by Lee Gill. Went to the outside, rim road around turn number two, and he got out in front. That boxed in Charlie Sandercock for a little while, and I think that was a critical thing for what was going to happen a few laps later. Sandercock in the 57, trying to knife his way through all the lap traffic, tried to make a quick move around Andy Mayhew and Sean Beardsley. The gap closed a little bit too early, and Sandercock got sideways. It would break John Waters. We saw what happened to Wayne Mohawk, along with the 18 of Sean Beardsley.
A lot of heavily damaged cars. Yes. Kevin Cook, though, would have a great night here using his Brewer and setup, and he would take the lead away from Lee Gill.
Yeah, not sure if there was an issue with the tire sealing over on some of the other guys. We heard Lee Gill mention that in the post-race interview. Whatever it was, Cook got out in front. Gill actually went back to third as Sandercock found the fast lane, got up into second. It's hard to remember now.
I know.
Lee Gill did not have really the best car for a lot of the race here tonight. They made some heavy contact, though, on the front stretch, and then it was Sandercock getting out in front. Cook tried to rebuttal, and the door slammed shut going into turn number three.
Cook went around, but like we said, he would battle back up to finish in sixth. Looked like everything was all set for Charlie Sandercock until
he broke. Yep, went into turn number three. Everything was good, and then something happened in the right rear. Wild to see. That would give Lee Gill the lead, a five-lap sprint to the finish. No issues for him. He would pick up the win. A.J. Kingsley finished third. He's down with Paul.
He may have passed more cars than anybody on the racetrack tonight. That's A.J. Kingsley, who finishes in the third spot. This was a bit of a workout, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Lap 18, I was counting. I was in 12th still, and I was just wondering when I was going to catch a break, and I just started restarting on the outside every restart, and that was where I was running, so I just stayed there. And that last restart, the last caution came out, and I'm third. I just was thinking to myself, how did that happen? I didn't realize that I was that far ahead. So I just kind of paced myself. The car took a couple laps to fire, but once it got fired, I could make up a lot of ground. Just wish it was one more lap. I could have had second, hopefully.
AJ Kingsley with a third place finish here tonight.
Did a great job, passed a lot of cars to get there. There's our shot of Victory Hill. And, gee, those two cars have something similar on their quarter panels, don't they?
A couple gyps and back cars in Victory Lane and sharing the moment together. But, Doug, six races for us this season on the Atomic Power Racing Hour, and that's it for 2015.
We hope you guys had a great time. We finished out with a real good one tonight. It's been a great season. We hope to see you back again next year on the Atomic Power Racing Hour.